Welcome to Useful Idiots, Dr. Christian Bruchel, and thank you so much for coming on. So if we could just begin with, you're the president, I believe, of the Global Virus Network. Could you tell us what that is?
Yeah, the Global Virus Network is a network of about 53 research centers all over the world. It's coordinated from Baltimore and also Tampa. I'm also, as I said, a professor at the University of South Florida. And this had been created a few years ago by Bob Gallo, who is a very famous virologist. And it's really about merging the best experts in virology all over the world to really fight against all viruses. Obviously, nowadays, COVID-19 is at the forefront of the fight, but we are really working on all viruses. And you see, the idea is that we need to find new mechanisms to fight against infectious disease. Obviously, in each country, you have research agencies. In the US, you have the NIH, and this is extremely powerful. You have large foundations, such as the Gates Foundation and so on. But we need mechanisms where very rapidly you can get all experts on one topic, working together, collaborating. And this is really what the Global Virus Network is about.
And that was the conception of putting that group together, was to have essentially a kind of rapid response group of experts from around the world.
Right? Exactly, rapid and collaborative, you see.
Collaborative, and as opposed to competitive, right?
Exactly.
So when you're in a situation like this, and if I understand correctly, your expertise originally was in liver diseases and the hepatology, but for any new contagion that arises, what's the first step? How do you identify what the disease is, and who does that kind of work, and how is it done in this case?
Yeah, well, that's a very good question, because actually this is one of the lessons we must take from COVID-19, because we have been insufficient prepared for this. The key for all these infectious diseases is rapid identification by rapid testing, then contact tracing, and then isolation. And for example, in South Korea, in Taiwan, and also to some extent in Germany, they have been able to be very efficient, you see. And then you can really contain an infectious disease. But if you do not succeed to do this because you do not have enough diagnostic testing, because you do not have enough capacities for tracing, for isolating, then you have the spreading, okay? Mm-hmm. And so if you have lost, I would say, the first battle, because you have not been able to limit the spreading, then you have to contain. And this is what has been done in many countries. And this has been efficient. Because you see, a virus is both a very astute organism, mm-hmm. very intelligent in a way, unfortunately, and at the same time, completely dependent on us. Because a virus cannot live by itself.
Right.
So if you contain and if you limit the number of people who can be infected, well, the virus will disappear by itself. So now, obviously, the containment by itself is not sufficient to get the virus disappear. But it has really limited the spread. And what we see now worldwide, in Europe, in the US, in all continents, is that we have been able to contain the spreading of the virus. So now we are coming to the third phase. And then we are in really, I would say, unexplored territories. Is how do you relieve a containment?
Mm-hmm.
Because you cannot be contained forever. I mean, you have, obviously, economic, but also psychologics, sociological consequences, which are enormous. We see this every day. So you have to relax the containment. But at the same time, obviously what you want to avoid is just to have the second wave and you lose everything and you have to recontain. And for this, it's both simple and complicated. It's just respecting very simple rules: physical distance, mask, washing the hands, and avoiding large gatherings.
And how do you find out what kind of disease this is? Is it RNA testing, DNA testing? Like, how do you isolate and identify the virus at the beginning of the process? And what does that tell you?
Yeah, nowadays we have technological. We have made some technology progress which are huge. I mean, so you can in a very few days isolate the nucleic acids, DNA or RNA, and you sequence, and you know which virus, which bacteria it is about. And then in a second step, you can generate antibodies, antibodies detecting serological assays, you see, because you have the sequence of the virus or of the bacteria. Now, just to explain, for the Ebola, for example, that was 2014, 2015, well, it took some time to get the sequence. But this time, I mean, the sequence has been obtained in, I don't know, 3 days, 4 days, you see?
Right, it was early January.
December, early January.
Yeah.
So this, I mean, we do not have only negative points regarding COVID-19. We also have positive one. You see, we have fantastic progress in technology, in science, but we have to use it for the best of the control of the fight against epidemics. So we have to connect science, surveillance, politics, I would say as a whole, and coordination of politics.
The sequencing can tell us a lot, right? It can tell us how old the disease is, its origins. What did we learn from the sequencing of this disease?
The sequence will tell you about, obviously, the agent, the nature of the agent. Is it a DNA and RNA? Does it belong? You see, in this case, the Chinese colleague, they were discovering a new agent. So what is it about? Well, it's a member of the coronavirus family. Okay, so we know about the previous coronaviruses, you see. So it already provides you a lot of information as to which type of disease we are talking about. Then what you can do is what we call a phylogenetic. In a way, it's a kind of a genealogic tree of where this virus comes from. So you start and you trace. You trace all the infected individuals and you sequence the virus for all of them. And we have a database. So this is great because now we have really a sharing of information. We have a database. They have, I believe, up to 10,000 sequences of viral genomes now all over the world.
Wow.
So you can say, okay, the spreading started there and then the virus came there and how it goes. But beyond this, what you really want to understand is how did it start? Where did it come from? And this is how they learned that this virus was very likely, now this is nearly for sure, generated by a recombination between a virus coming from bats with animals such as the famous pangolin,
right,
which which is at the forefront of the conversations, which is a kind of horrible small mammifers that you would never like to eat, but some people eat it.
It's a funny looking animal for sure.
Yeah. And so that's really what this what they learn actually. And now the key question is, do we think that this virus is evolving, you see? Because when you have an RNA virus, this is an RNA virus, when the virus multiplies, the enzyme which drives the replication of the virus, of the viral genome, makes mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So each time you have a new virus, you have just a handful, maybe one or two or three mutations. But they will allow you to pinpoint the difference. Now, this may only be useful, as I said, to trace the virus. But this may have other consequences. For example, would it may modify
could it modify the envelope of the virus? So then, might this impact the efficacy of the future vaccines? You see? Or right. not? I'm not telling that this is the case, you see, but this is a question you ask yourself.
Right.
And then you have another question. Is it possible that this virus, by evolving, would induce more severe lesions, you see, mm-hmm. because of the genetic variability? We do not have evidence so far for this, fortunately. But there has been one report a few days ago, but we have to be very careful, you see, because things need to be verified. But the claim they make is that maybe from the original virus, some strains emerge, which are more contagious right. and they spread to Europe and then to the US. Okay? Mm-hmm. This has to be confirmed because you see, a problem we have, the good point is that we have a huge effort of the international medical scientific community. I have been the head of a large research institution before coming in the US. I've been the head of the French NIH, of the Institut Pasteur. So I have really witnessed many crises, you see. I have never seen such an effort. So that's very good. Then everybody wants to publish, which is very good because you want to have transparency and publish your data. Mm-hmm. But then things go so fast that you have many papers, they have just not been reviewed by experts, you see?
Right.
And they are online. So we have to be careful with the results. We have to be sure that they are verified. But to your point, sequence analysis tells you which virus, gives you an idea of the disease, allows you to trace the virus, and maybe and allows you to ask important questions as to the genetic variability.
Just to follow up on that point about the mutations that were reported a few days ago, I read phrases like deletions may reduce viral fitness. Like, can the mutation make the disease, can it hurt the disease? How would that work out? I mean, I read things like, if it makes it more lethal, it'll actually kill its host faster, and maybe that will reduce the spread. What are they talking about when they use phrases like that?
No, you see, SARS-CoV-1, the first SARS in 2003, 2004, okay? Very deadly viral infections, up to 15% of infected patients died, okay? Ebola virus, up to 60-70% of death. Well, this virus, they will not propagate so easily because they kill many of their hosts, you see? And if you kill your host, you are left without a host to spread.
Right.
So this is what they mean, you see? Mm-hmm. If you have a virus, now the problem we have with SARS-CoV-2 is that very unfortunately, this is one of the best combination because it is deadly. It does induce death, but not too much. Mm. Not too much. And it's very contagious. And so this is a situation where you have, for the virus, all the opportunity to spread. You don't kill too much your host. It's very cynical what I'm telling you.
Mm-hmm, right.
This is a point
rude,
of view of the
guess.
This is a point of view of the virus, you see.
Right. You have to think like it though.
Yeah. Do you think of the virus, like when you're thinking about this or working on it or analyzing it, do you kind of think of it as like as an analytical being?
Well, that's an interesting point. I frankly, yes, sometimes.
Because it helps you like figure it out,
yeah.
Right?
You see, I mean, viruses have been with us for such a long time. I mean, you see, when we came to Earth, I mean, we had viruses. And many of these viruses, they have been our friends. They have helped us to shape what we are. For example, some retroviruses, we call them, which are present in our genome, they have been very important for women to get pregnant, I mean, to have the placenta and the newborns and so on. And then we have this these enemies. So yes, this is maybe because I'm living in the virology all day, but I have a tendency to think to them as a kind of special organisms which want to get rid of us, actually.
Yeah.
Right. Or at least survive, right?
How do you decide whether a virus is a good candidate for a vaccine, and what kind of approach are you going to take when you're trying to what are the steps that you have to take at the beginning to try to develop a vaccine?
First, you have to think in a very bold way. Mm-hmm. We have no possibility at the beginning to really bet on a better vaccine process than the others. Now, this may depend on the virus. For example, you have some viruses. They are part of the family of other viruses where we know that efficient vaccines were generated against. Okay? So, logically, you will use the same path to develop the vaccines as the one which were used for the previous one. But this is not the case for coronavirus. So, we have to take, and this is a very good point for what is being done. Everything is being tried at the same time. And that's the way to do. We have more than 130 candidates. This is incredible. I mean, it's so hard to follow up even, I mean, to really. But that's very good because we will see which one is the best, you see. Mm-hmm. So you cannot decide. So obviously, each of the group will decide based generally on their experience. I know how to use, missile viruses as a vector. Okay, I will use missile viruses for coronavirus, you see? Mm-hmm. And then I know how to use, how to engineer the envelope protein. Okay, I will engineer the envelope protein of SARS-CoV-2. But at the end of the day, when you look at the overall pictures, you will see coming in all areas. So we will know. We will know soon. And you see, I'm absolutely convinced, and first, we have to be very humble because this virus, I mean, we have been caught by surprise on many things. So what I really keep repeating is that it's good to have experts. It's nice to have scientists and to discuss with them, but they have to be humble, which is important. And then, having said that, I really believe that we will have a vaccine, you see. So seems obvious to say it, okay, we will have a vaccine. Yeah, it's anything but obvious because so far on coronavirus, we have had a hard time to get vaccines. But I really believe this. When that become a little bit controversial, because you have announcements, we have the vaccine, we will have next October. At worst, it will be early January. Maybe there is a confusion between, you see, having a first proof of efficacy of a vaccine, which is very good, and having a vaccine that you can use for mass vaccination. And then comes a very important point, which is safety and also the trust from the population. Because there have been a very interesting poll on some, I don't know, not only in France, I believe also in the US, I don't remember exactly where. The question was, oh, are you going to be vaccinated against SARS-CoV-2? Well, you would expect to have 19.99% of positive answers. Not at all. Not at all.
Not in America.
Many people said, oh, no. And you can understand maybe why. So you really have to ensure absolute safety of the product. So then it takes some time. So I really hope I'm wrong. I really hope I'm wrong. But if I have to express my opinion, I hardly believe that we could have the vaccine before summer 2021, end of 2021. Some people would disagree with me. And again, I would be very, very happy to be wrong. Very happy. But then you have a very interesting point, which is the following. If you have a vaccine, which is only partly efficient. Okay, you know that you cannot control everything, but you can have an effect. Well, then you can use this if you have, for example, new burst of infection somewhere, you see? So it's not a mass vaccination worldwide, but you can use it to control. So that's really an important point. And finally, regarding vaccination, and this is where science presently is really exploding, you can have non-specific stimulation. For example, there are some reports which really suggest, and this makes sense, that BCG therapy, so which is a vaccine against tuberculosis, mm-hmm. not only protects against tuberculosis, but induce a kind of bystander effect by protecting against other bacteria or viruses. Mm. And actually, there are clinical trials ongoing now in Europe and also in Australia, I believe, where they are testing this possibility. So you see, not only you can have a specific vaccine against the coronavirus, but you can stimulate the protection, our defense mechanisms against the virus. And there is a second orientation that we have been also very much promoting with Bob Gallo in the Global Virus Network, is to use polio vaccines, oral polio vaccines. For a number of reasons, I will not go into detail, there is some evidence in other models that it might, again, provide a kind of non-specific stimulation of the defense against the coronavirus. So you see, it goes into so many directions, but this is very positive.
So that idea is the oral polio vaccine might have a kind of secondary effect of increasing the antivirus, the immune response against coronavirus. Yeah. That's really interesting.
Yeah, and possibly also interfering with the viral replication, with the SARS-CoV-2 by some mechanisms. Yes, it's very, very interesting.
Yeah. And is that something that's new that you've only discovered in the course of this?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, no. This is also where you need the old guys, you see, and you need the memory. It's right. About ancient virological concepts mm-hmm. that you bring back with the memory. And you see, this is very interesting. Virology in general and worldwide, virology in general over the next 20, 25 years has been underappreciated. Mm. B, for the recruitment of new scientists, I have seen this when I was in my previous positions. I see this in the US. B, on the support. You see, there has been this idea that, of course, yes, we have infectious agents. Yes, of course. But what is important is cancer, diabetes, Alzheimer's, and so on, which is true, obviously. I'm not telling that we should forget about this disease. But what COVID-19 reminds us, it says, hey, this is not finished. This is not over. We are there.
Right.
And we can get you.
Yeah.
And this is what we have to remember.
It feels like so much science and medicine is immediately like interconnected with politics. But it seems like virology is even more in some ways than other spheres. How much of your time is spent thinking about politics and the interaction between viruses and politics? Is it even possible to not think about politics in your field of work and study?
Well, I'm trying to think as less as possible on the connection between virology and politics. No, but your point is well taken. And for example, at the University of South Florida, I'm in charge of a task force on COVID-19. And this is really a transdisciplinary aspect where we bring together not only technology, science, but also humanities, behavioral science, and politics. This is why I'm coming to this. And yes, we need to analyze. We need to investigate these interactions because, I mean, you see, after Ebola crisis, we have witnessed a lot of progress in global public health worldwide. The WHO was reorganized in part. We had a new coordination mechanism. So that was very positive. And you see, if we were to have this interview say 8 months ago, and you would ask me, do you think that we have made progress in the global health over the past year? The answer would be yes, because this is true. And this is why it gets crazy. I mean, at the same time, we have been again caught by surprise on this. So it means that we have to go for politics, but politics in the positive sense of the word. That means how to better harmonize our way to react. You see, the way the countries have been reacting has been, okay, I close my borders. Right. I don't want to think of anybody else. I just want to be reelected. So I have to show to my population that I'm protecting them. Okay? That's a little bit sharp, but that's sure. about true. Okay? And that's not the way to do it. Because you see, Louis Pasteur has been the first to say, okay, sorry, but the viruses, the bacteria, they don't know the borders.
Right. Yeah. And, right. It is. It's interesting because it, I think it can kind of shape consciousness in a way about how we see the world and each other. Because if things, if viruses are international or like transcend nation states and borders, that can affect the way, you know, the decisions of different governments or even just how people see each other.
Absolutely. No, but you see, I mean, we spend at least 5 to 10 years analyzing what has happened. You see, we have never witnessed how a single virus can disorganize the world. And yes, I mean, and it's about, so for me, politics, you have, obviously, we do have contacts with politics and it's about providing advice, which is very good. And it's about trying to calm down some politicians and so on. But it's also, I mean, more interestingly, I would say, it's really about shaping the future of the way we want to think after this crisis.
Right.
You talked about virology being neglected. Do you think that's over? Do you think it's not going to be neglected anymore? I mean, obviously, you know, when something like HIV happens, suddenly everybody needs virologists. But that problem eventually came under control. But this one has been so serious and so affecting that I would imagine that there's not going to be that kind of neglect again. At least anytime soon, or am I wrong about that?
No, no, I believe you are absolutely right. Mm-hmm. This will change the way we see. And now it's also, I would say, we need to have what I call the new virology. You see, the new virology is a virology which integrates the old concepts. You see, how do you cultivate a virus? How do you understand some very basic things about virus? But this you have to incorporate into the new technologies. We were talking about genome analysis, you see. And then it's about all what is offering the artificial intelligence, contact tracing, and it's about humanities, behavioral. So for me, the new virology is a virology where obviously, it's about the best experts, finding treatment, finding vaccines, and so on. But integrating the virology, you see, into the whole science. So I'm sure that it would be very different. Yes, I'm really sure.
Were you scared when you heard Trump suggest bleach, injecting bleach, or whatever his theories are? Does that give you, like, does that make your heart beat faster? Or is that something you expect now regularly from Trump? His like new scientific theory of the day, or?
Well, I believe that they have realized that there is a point you should not reach. I mean, I believe that, I don't want to be, provocative and so on, but I believe that you have to be careful when you speak.
Right. When people, everybody's so desperate to get their lives back to normal, what's the best hope? Is it a vaccine? Is it the disease mutating? Is it the development of some kind of treatment? Or is it a combination of all these things? There's no vector control here, but what should people be putting their hopes in?
Certainly not the vaccine. The vaccine will be there to prevent the new rounds, you see.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And that would be very important, obviously, but that's for the future, the way I see it. Mm-hmm. Now, you see, you have first to answer really to your question. First, we don't know. You cannot exclude that with the summer. You see, for example, the virus does not like heat, but even more than this, it doesn't like humidity, you see. Mm-hmm. So for example, in Florida, well, we have humidity. So you cannot exclude the fact of this seasonal effect, and that just with the summer, but the problem is summer is here, but it means winter in other continents, you see, so it doesn't solve right. everything. But you cannot exclude that there will be a seasonal effect which will have a significant impact. Having said that, my hope is the hope I really put on first, simple people meeting with respecting physical distance, mask, and no gathering. Okay? Mm-hmm. That's first. And then treatment. I believe that treatments are really making a lot of progress. And for me, the new challenge, but it is too early, but we have some hints, is preventive treatment. Is it possible to have therapies which with very little or no side effects that you can take if you have been in contact with somebody, if you are at risk, you see, of COVID-19. That mm-hmm. would change in everything. So my hope is a combination of seasonal variations, respecting very simple measures, and possibly adding on this all the bulk of treatment. And that would make the bridge with the occurrence of vaccines, which then would allow us to be to prevent all the new rounds over the next years.
Does this, in terms of the socio-political aspect, do you think that this makes the case for something like Medicare for All? And do you have any thoughts on how social distancing should be achieved, whether more through punishment or more through education?
Well, that's two very tricky questions.
Even for the end.
Specializes in those.
I'm a sneaky virus. You think you got rid of me. And I'm
I would take the second first. It's really, that's a very difficult question because it really depends of the population. For example, in South Korea, people will not react the same as in France, in Italy, or in South America, you see. But in general, I would go for obligatory. And I know that, again, many people would disagree with me, and I may be wrong, but I believe that you see that's the only way. Mm-hmm. To make it, just to explain that this is part of life for a number. Now, regarding Medicare for All, I mean, it depends how you want. In any case, you see, it advocates for reinforcing the social measures to taking care of individuals. You see, I'm living, obviously, in the US now, and very pleased to do so, but also, obviously, keeping my roots in France, you see. Right. So two very different systems, you see. And actually, well, this crisis really shows the benefit of the French system, I mean. And when I see in the U.S. so many people in unemployment, I mean, this is heartbreaking, I mean, the way. So I believe I'm not in a position to say, okay, it has to be Medicare for All, but it has anyway, whatever the final mechanisms, it will call for thinking really further on a mechanism to really take care, to better take care of people. That's for sure. And this is what we are learning worldwide.
So more of a safety net.
Yes, exactly.
Less of a safety net, yeah.
Is there anything about this disease that's still surprising or mysterious to scientists at this point? Like, I remember talking to doctors early in this crisis and having them say, you know, it doesn't act like influenza, like it acts like altitude sickness. Yeah. It has a very odd effect on patients. Like they, you know, they sit in the waiting room and they look fine, but they're hypoxic. Like Is there something that's still unusual and ununderstood about this disease?
There are many things, and this is incredible. We have to understand exactly what you said. Why do we have this delayed and very sudden respiratory distress in some patients with what we call the cytokine storm? How does it work? Why do we have these neurological disorders? This is incredible. And we don't have time to speak about this, but there is a fantastic hypothesis which has been put forward by French scientists on the use of patch of nicotine to treat COVID-19. I'm not advocating for smoking. I'm advocating for patch of nicotine. So neuroscience, we have just now, I mean, we have coagulation disorders. We have vascular disorders that we do not understand. So this virus has a lot, we have a lot to understand regarding how this virus, the disease that which is induced by this virus. This is just crazy, actually. We are discovering.
Wow, it's fascinating. Yeah. Doctor, thank you so much for coming on. Yeah. I really appreciate it. You've taught us a lot and you've taught our listeners a lot. And we wish you the best of luck as you progress and try to fight this disease.
Well, thank you so much. Very interesting conversation. Yeah.
Thank you. Take care now.
That was amazing. That was wonderful, right?
Super interesting.
I have a theory. I think I know What's that? Comes from. Kurt Loder.
Kurt Lotus is Loder is patient zero?
Yeah. He's like organism zero. He's virus. we think he's ageless. And then when he was talking about like, where does it come from? We have to look into the history, look where it comes from, the genealogical stuff. I was like, I'm not even kidding. I thought of Kurt Loder.
He came out of a Scottish lock.
Yeah, exactly.
In 1175.
Yeah.
And with the virus. You know, that was super interesting, and actually his demeanor and his positivity is the first optimistic thing I've gotten out of his news cycle.
Yeah, he's very calming. I liked how he does seem to really think of them as little, like, annoying. They're almost like frenemies, or frenemies, these viruses. You know what I mean?
Well, yeah, it was kind of complimentary. Like, you know, they are very smart.
It's true, yeah. I remember the only science I like is when I can, like, imagine, like, the intelligence of these characters. I know that maybe sounds weird, but and I can imagine when I understand the motives.
Well, I mean, it's also a great detective story.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think the people like this who are, you know, they're looking at thousands of clues, and there's the answer is somewhere in, you know, he's talking about there's 130 candidates. That means that there's all these teams of people who are producing reams of research every single day. And just trying to imagine the intellectual bandwidth you have to be able to pay attention to all of that and try to put together what's useful over here versus what's useful over here, and coming up with a solution out of all of that. I mean, it's a pretty thrilling story. I mean, when all is said and done, when they finally do come up with something for this, it's going to make a great book,
right,
for somebody. Yeah. And it's, you know, fascinating to follow right now.
Yeah, I hope the virus has a good agent. Agent, I didn't even think of that.
All right, cool. Well, thanks for tuning in to Useful Idiots, and we'll see you next week.
Great. And buy the merch. Where can people find merch? Go to Useful Idiots. We have the link in our YouTube videos. We have the links in our podcast also.
Or if you don't want to buy it, find Kurt Loder in an old painting.
Oh yeah, and then we'll send it to you. Acting as a viral parasite. Yeah.
But it's got to be convincing. I mean, it's not like we're just going to give it to you if it's close. It's got to be him.
Yeah, it's got to actually be photographic evidence of him at the beginning of time.
Right.
Yeah.
So we'll give you a t-shirt for that. Good luck.
Yes.
Yeah. All right. Thanks a lot. We'll see you next week.